This session will focus on improving the specificity of breast ultrasound by reducing unnecessary short-term follow-up of BI-RADS 3 lesions and reducing biopsy of benign BI-RADS 4A lesions. The objectives for this session are that by the end of it, you will have confidence in assessing oval circumscribed masses and clustered microcysts seen on screening ultrasound and know when 12-month, 6-month follow-up or biopsy is appropriate. You'll be able to discuss the use of BI-RADS 3 for palpable masses and also understand how elastography may be able to help us with BI-RADS 3 and 4A lesions seen on ultrasound. The more accurate our imaging is, the better it is for our patients, and we can improve accuracy by improving cancer detection or sensitivity. This requires optimal technique, correlation with other modalities, and careful radiologic pathologic concordance. Importantly, we also need to reduce false positives, and that is an improvement in specificity, by reducing biopsy and follow-up of benign lesions. And this is particularly an issue for screening ultrasound. To improve specificity, again, we're going to focus on BI-RADS 3, probably benign lesions, and 4A, low suspicion lesions, seen on handheld ultrasound. And I will show you that there is substantial literature supporting 12-month follow-up for the vast majority of BI-RADS 3 lesions seen on screening ultrasound and a single 6-month follow-up of a probable fibroadenoma in younger women under age 35. There are also several ways that we can approach reclassifying BI-RADS 4A masses as BI-RADS 3 and reducing unnecessary biopsies. A BI-RADS 3 assessment was first developed for mammography and specifically baseline mammography or when there were no prior comparisons. And these, of course, are findings that have been shown to have less than 2% risk of malignancy at 2-year follow-up. And typically we would do a 6-month, 12-month, and 24-month follow-up if the findings are stable. This does require recall for additional imaging, that is, the screen would be considered BI-RADS 0 incomplete, and we would do either additional views or ultrasound or both. A solitary circumscribed mass, focal asymmetry, and group of punctate calcifications are all findings that have been validated as appropriate for BI-RADS 3 assessments on screening mammography. Importantly, that follow-up and resulting delay in diagnosis of the few malignancies that are followed does not result in worse prognosis for the patient. There's no worse stage distribution or more likely nodal involvement because of that follow-up, and that's an important corollary also for BI-RADS 3 assessment. This is a nice example of a typical BI-RADS 3 lesion on baseline screening mammography, and in this case tomosynthesis, a circumscribed oval mass seen in both views and was solid on ultrasound. Typically this would be assessed as BI-RADS 3 with a 6-month follow-up. This patient preferred biopsy and this was a fibroadenoma. Tom Stavros and colleagues were the first to describe features of masses on ultrasound that could be appropriately classified as BI-RADS 3, probably benign. This included masses that were uniformly hyperechoic and those that had an oval shape, including 2 or 3 gentle lobulations, a pseudocapsule, which is no longer a term in use, but these are circumscribed masses, with no suspicious features, and that is no posterior shadowing, marked hypoechogenicity, spiculation, microlobulation, angular margins, or vertical orientation. This patient was noted to have an enlarging mass on screening tomosynthesis, possibly containing fat. On ultrasound, a uniformly hyperechoic mass, and this was biopsied because it was new mammographically, and this was a benign angiolipoma. Similar criteria were used in the Akron 6666 protocol, where circumscribed oval hypoechoic masses with parallel orientation and either no or minimal posterior enhancement were considered probably benign, most of these being fibroadenomas or complicated cysts with debris with an occasional oil cyst appearing hypoechoic. Clustered microcysts were also considered BI-RADS 3 in the Akron protocol and are now BI-RADS 2 generally. Probable fat necrosis can have a very short interval follow-up, and scars that are due to surgery may sometimes be difficult to recognize. For findings on screening ultrasound that are otherwise BI-RADS 3, I'm going to show you that the risk of malignancy is far less than 1%, similar to a BI-RADS 1 or 2 assessment, and therefore 12-month follow-up is a reasonable alternative to a 6-month follow-up for most BI-RADS 3 lesions seen on screening ultrasound. Further, a final assessment of BI-RADS 3 can be given directly on screening ultrasound when it is done with handheld technique, and again, we'll talk about that more. Across the literature of technologists performed screening ultrasound on the first prevalent screen, about 13% of patients will be recalled for additional testing. This includes immediate additional evaluation, as well as BI-RADS 3 assessments, as well as direct BI-RADS 4 or even 5 assessments. About 2/3 of those recalls, or 8% of all women, will be recalled for a BI-RADS 3 assessment, and this is actually a recommendation typically for 6-month follow-up, but as I mentioned, ultimately this can be a BI-RADS 3 with a 12-month follow-up recommendation. Only 0.3% across these series were recalled for additional immediate evaluation prior to a final assessment. Importantly, in these series of technologists performed screening ultrasound, there were no malignancies identified at initial short interval follow-up where it was performed. In screening ultrasound performed by physicians, you can see that in the Akron trial in year one, we had a 15% recall rate attributed to addition of ultrasound. This was much lower with incidence screening when we had prior comparisons. Only 7% of patients were recalled. Looking at the outcomes of BI-RADS 3 lesions on screening ultrasound performed by physicians, only 2 lesions out of 1,835, or 0.1%, were actually malignant at 6-month follow-up, and only 0.5% were malignant at 2-year follow-up. Very low rates of malignancy, similar to BI-RADS 1 or 2 lesions. Importantly, we found in the Akron study that about 20% of patients had BI-RADS 3 lesions across 3 years of screening. Interestingly, you know, most of those were identified in the initial screening ultrasound exam, but you can see that there were additional BI-RADS 3 lesions seen even at the 12-month and 24-month follow-up. So new lesions can be seen on screening ultrasound across the years. This is an important distinction from mammography, where BI-RADS 3 was really developed for baseline findings or in the absence of prior comparison, not for new findings. In the Akron trial, overall, we had a 0.8% malignancy rate for BI-RADS 3 lesions. Only 1 malignancy was found at 6-month follow-up, and we proposed that 12-month follow-up was likely sufficient for the usual BI-RADS 3 lesion. I recently reviewed 15 series that looked at issues of BI-RADS 3 on screening ultrasound, and across nearly 4,000 lesions at 6 months, only 0.2% of these findings were malignant, which is comparable to BI-RADS 2 assessment. And even at 2 years of follow-up, only almost 0.4% were cancer, and the cancers were not at more advanced stage. So this indeed supports that a 12-month follow-up is appropriate for a typical BI-RADS 3 lesion seen on screening ultrasound. Historically, findings on automated ultrasound are generally recalled for targeted handheld ultrasound prior to giving a final assessment. However, Dr. Richard Barr and colleagues actually studied this issue, and in 394 women given a BI-RADS 3 assessment directly on automated ultrasound, where they had 2-year follow-up, there were no malignancies in that quadrant. And his hypothesis is that these patients as well can be returned to routine screening. Many findings that historically were classified as BI-RADS 3 on screening ultrasound should actually be now considered BI-RADS 2 benign findings. This includes complicated cysts with debris, solid masses that are oval and circumscribed with rim calcification, clustered microcysts, we'll talk more about these, and lymph nodes, with rare exception. Across the ACRIN participants, we found 14% of women had at least one complicated cyst with debris. Many of them, about 80%, also had a simple cyst, so the company they keep is likely suggestive as well. Many of these were multiple and bilateral, but overall only 2 out of 475, or 0.4%, were malignant on follow-up. Across the literature, there are other studies showing that complicated cysts can be classified as benign findings with only 0.3% malignancy rate across these series. This lesion could either be a complicated cyst with debris or fibroadenoma, but in any event is appropriate for categorization as BI-RADS 3 with 12-month follow-up when seen on screening ultrasound. This proved to be stable at 3 years of follow-up and is a presumed fibroadenoma. Most complicated cysts will either decrease or increase over time. That same patient in the same breast had a second lesion that looked at first glance like a complicated cyst with debris, but it has indistinct margins, particularly on the middle image, and there was some adjacent vascularity, which is neither here nor there. This was biopsied based on its appearance and was a 1.2 centimeter grade 2 invasive ductal carcinoma. Here is an example of a patient with subtle rim calcification that you can appreciate where the arrows are on the left-hand image around this. Here is another mass that appears to have peripheral rim calcification. Might even be intraductal based on its location near the nipple, and it appears to be surrounded by a few ducts. This patient had ipsilateral cancer, and this was an enhancing mass on MRI, prompting biopsy, which showed cholesterol granuloma, macrophages, and apocrine metaplasia consistent with a ruptured cyst. Unlike the previous examples, this mass seen on screening ultrasound in a woman who had many other cysts in her breasts demonstrates some indistinctness of the margins and even microlobulation. This does have a more suspicious appearance. This mass was also highly vascular on power Doppler, confirming that it is not a complicated cyst with debris, but rather a solid and therefore suspicious mass given its margins. This underwent biopsy, with core biopsy showing atypical papilloma, excised showing grade 2 DCIS. Here is another mass that at first glance might look like a complicated cyst with debris, but it is indistinctly marginated. In both views, it's subtle, but it's important to carefully scrutinize the margins. This was a triple negative invasive ductal carcinoma on biopsy. Here's a small mass that corresponded with a new mass on mammography. The patient had had prior cancer in the same breast. She did not return at 6 months, but at 12-month follow-up, this had moderately enlarged, and this was papillary DCIS. This case brings up an important point, and that is that if there's a corresponding mammographic abnormality, the risk of malignancy of an otherwise circumscribed mass on ultrasound is a bit higher. These investigators found 2.2% malignancy rate in that setting, but findings seen only incidentally on ultrasound had only 0.4% malignancy rate. So if there's a mammographic abnormality, it should be seen at 6-month follow-up on a baseline. Here is an older woman. That's another issue I wanted to make sure that we were all aware of. She had a small mass seen on mammography, but it wasn't noticed or recalled for several years, but you can appreciate that it was gradually enlarging on the mammograms. On ultrasound at first glance, it almost looks like a simple cyst, maybe with a single echogenic calcification within it. But it was enlarging, and here are some additional images. You can see that on Doppler, it did have some internal vascularity, which also excludes that it's a cyst, as we mentioned. And this then underwent biopsy and was intermediate nuclear grade DCIS. I've been collaborating with Cindy Lee at NYU on analyses from the National Mammography Database, And interestingly, not surprisingly, we found that the risk of malignancy for BI-RADS 3 lesions increases with increasing age. And actually, over the age of 60, the malignancy rate exceeded 2%, and you can see it's even higher in women in their 70s and 80s. Clustered microcysts are very common. I've looked at these several times. About 5% of screening ultrasound examinations will have clustered microcysts. They're most common in perimenopausal women with a mean age of 48. Very unlikely to be malignant across series, only one out of 526 such lesions. But I would caution you that if this is a new mass again on the mammogram, especially in a postmenopausal woman not on hormone replacement therapy, that it may merit biopsy in that setting. We know that these represent the terminal duct lobular unit where there is dilatation of the acini. There may or may not be associated apocrine metaplasia in the lining of these microcysts or dilated acini. Here's a nice example of a 48-year-old woman with a new mass on screening mammography. Targeted ultrasound shows a classic appearance of clustered microcysts. This can be dismissed as a benign finding by BI-RADS 2. Here's another patient who had a new mass on screening mammogram, age 45. Targeted ultrasound again shows clustered microcysts. There can be small, complicated microcysts with debris. And again, if there's apocrine metaplasia, the lining can be a bit thicker and it can almost appear solid in portions. This is still a benign finding. Harmonic imaging, especially, can help clear things up as it did on the right-hand image here. In the contralateral breast, she was noted to have a small mass of the nipple on ultrasound. You can see if you look carefully, there is rim calcification as shown by the arrows, and that should be a major clue that this is a benign finding and does not require biopsy. This is the corresponding mammogram, and despite these findings, she actually had bilateral biopsy showing fibrocystic changes on the right and calcifying cyst on the left that were both avoidable biopsies. Those all could have been dismissed as benign findings. Here's a 60-year-old woman who had an ipsilateral cancer elsewhere in the same breast, and on mammography, there was a microlobulated mass. On ultrasound, it appears to be clustered microcysts. The margins are a bit indistinct in the top right image. This was biopsied because of the enhancement on MRI and in view of the ipsilateral cancer, and this was grade 2 DCIS. Here's another patient who had screening ultrasound due to dense breasts and prior atypical ductal hyperplasia. She had an irregular mass, cysts, and this small mass just above the cyst that looks to be a complicated cyst with debris, but we now know that this is in a patient who has current ipsilateral suspicious mass. Here's that same mass above the simple cyst, and it did have internal vascularity on Doppler, and this was again low-grade DCIS. And a very important paper looking at BI-RADS 3 lesions synchronous to a new cancer showed that unlike a patient without any current cancer history, where we see a 2% malignancy rate, there was actually an 11% malignancy rate among these findings, much more likely malignant if it was in the same quadrant as the primary malignancy. 21% were malignant, about 10% if it was in the different quadrant of the same breast, and about 4% in the contralateral breast. So we don't use BI-RADS 3 in a patient who has a known current newly diagnosed cancer. We would pursue biopsy in that setting. It is important to use optimal technique for screening ultrasound and especially documentation. It is standard to include orthogonal views for any lesion that is not a simple cyst. We also would include Doppler based on the criteria from the Akron 6666 trial. It's really not a complete screening ultrasound without such documentation, and that does not constitute additional imaging. Here's a nice example from Christophe Terrasse in France showing a circumscribed mass in one projection, but in the orthogonal view, you can see the mass has a small nose to it. This was papillary DCIS with microinvasion. Here is another lesion from screening ultrasound study that my colleague Denise Cho oversaw. This looks like microlobulated but circumscribed lesion on the transverse images. It's a small hypochoic mass on coronal images. And on one view targeted ultrasound, it looks like complicated cyst with debris, but the orthogonal view shows that it has some indistinct margins, and this was again grade 2 DCIS. A very similar finding, it appears to be a cyst in one view, but again appears to have some microlobulation. If you look closely, the margins may not be perfectly circumscribed. On Doppler, there was internal vascularity, and that small little microlobulation was actually an adjacent vessel, and this was a metastatic intramammary lymph node. So again, Doppler can be helpful. As on mammography, multiple bilateral circumscribed masses on screening ultrasound can be considered BI-RADS 2 findings. We had no malignancies in the Akron 6666 study. The confidence interval was up to 2.4%. It is important, however, to scrutinize each of these masses carefully. We did have two concurrent malignancies in women who had multiple bilateral circumscribed masses, and this has been identified as a source of false negative screening ultrasound interpretations due to multiple distracting lesions. What about palpable masses? Can they be considered BI-RADS 3? Absolutely. In young women, 34 and under, the vast majority of palpable masses that are circumscribed are going to be fibroadenomas. We often perform bilateral whole breast ultrasound at initial presentation in that setting in order to facilitate follow-up, because about 15% of fibroadenomas are multiple and bilateral. But the differential diagnosis includes two other lesions that tend to grow rapidly, specifically triple negative invasive ductal carcinoma and phalloides tumor. Because of that, a single 6-month follow-up may be sufficient in this context. Indeed, Marcone and colleagues looked at this very issue and found that the vast majority of probable fibroadenomas in young women that ultimately required biopsy were identified at the 6-month follow-up. There were no malignancies, but there were 4 phalloides tumors, and indeed only one additional mass required biopsy due to later enlargement and was still a benign fibroadenoma. The group at Yale looked at this issue as well, with probable fibroadenomas assessed as BI-RADS 3 on ultrasound, and found 96% of them were stable at the first follow-up, with the median follow-up of about 9 months. There was one lesion that was atypical ductal hyperplasia on biopsy at first follow-up, but that first follow-up didn't occur until 35 months later. And among those with continued follow-up, there were no malignancies. So again, it suggests that that single 6-month follow-up is likely sufficient. Palpable, probably benign lesions have a low malignancy rate of only 1.3% across multiple series. This is a very nice example of a patient who's 33 with two adjacent masses that appear to be fibroadenomas. They were palpable, and we did a 6-month follow-up, and you can see that the one on the left did not change, but the one on the right had marked interval change with marked enlargement, as well as internal hypo to anechoic clefts, and that prompted biopsy, of course, and this was a phalloides tumor. Phalloides tumors, of course, have these clefts where there's fluid between the leaf-like projections of the tumor, and they do require excision, and they will grow rapidly, which is distinct from most fibroadenomas. Paula Gordon and colleagues looked at this issue of growth of a presumed fibroadenoma. This was after FNAB diagnosis of fibroadenoma, and they showed that at any age, less than 20% growth in diameter was still a benign finding consistent with fibroadenoma, and excision was recommended if growth exceeded that 20% threshold, with 2 phalloides tumors identified in that setting. Keep in mind, if you do the math, that a 1 centimeter mass at time zero, of course, will be 1.2 centimeter in diameter at 6 months. That same mass would measure 1.4 centimeter at 12 months with the same growth rate of 20% in 6 months, 2.1 centimeter at 24 months, and actually 3 centimeter at 36 months, and that's still within accepted limits. Ha and colleagues in Seoul looked at growth of BI-RADS 3 lesions. There were 527 that grew more than 20% in diameter, and they found that among those that were enlarging, 5% were malignant, but that was still only 0.2% of all BI-RADS 3 lesions. And they interestingly noted that among lesions that showed only growth at follow-up, there was still only 2% malignancy rate. Most cancers had other suspicious changes, such as indistinct margins or spiculation developing or change in orientation or other suspicious features. I now want to turn to BI-RADS 4A masses. There is not a lot written to indicate exactly what lesions should be considered BI-RADS 4A. We know that we should be aiming for a risk of malignancy between 2 and about 10%. There are very few findings for which we know the risk of malignancy is in that range, but one of those findings would be an introductal mass, where most likely that's a papilloma. Another group of lesions, which really is the most common scenario, would be a probable fibroadenoma that has a focally indistinct or slightly angular margin, heterogeneous echotexture, vertical orientation, posterior shadowing, or a subtle suggestion of an echogenic rim. This is a good example of a BI-RADS 4A mass from my perspective. This was a finding on screening, actually screening mammography, and then ultrasound was done. A very subtle isoechoic mass, and I think you can appreciate now that there's a subtle surrounding echogenic rim. It's also not perfectly circumscribed. This was a grade 3 triple negative invasive ductal carcinoma. Here's another patient who has a lesion that is almost anechoic, but a little bit microlobulated and even angular on the right-hand image. And again, this is a grade 2 invasive ductal carcinoma. This was HER2 positive, ER-PR negative disease. Here is a mass that was seen on screening ultrasound that looks almost like a fibroadenoma, but has subtle distortion in the adjacent parenchyma, especially on the right-hand image. And this was a grade 2 invasive and introductal carcinoma. This patient has a solitary dilated duct on mammography, and that is a BI-RADS 4A finding on mammography. And on ultrasound, you could see the corresponding dilated duct with an introductal mass. And again, this is a BI-RADS 4A lesion. This was a benign papilloma without atypia. The largest series of introductal masses seen on ultrasound is from Kim and colleagues, where an 8% malignancy rate was demonstrated. 8 of the malignancies were DCIS and 5 were invasive ductal carcinoma. It was more likely that the introductal mass was malignant in patients who had symptoms, such as nipple discharge, or a personal history of breast cancer. It was also more likely when the introductal mass completely filled the duct and or its branches, or extended beyond the duct. Here is just a diagram of the various types of introductal masses. They found no malignancies with the incidental partially filling introductal mass that is almost always a papilloma. In our own practice, we now consider those BI-RADS 3 lesions and will do 6-month follow-up in lieu of biopsy unless the patient is symptomatic. The middle type 2 is filling the duct. 9% of those were malignant. And here where it's breaking through the wall of the duct with irregularity of the wall of the duct, all 4 of the lesions in the series of Kim et al. Were malignant that had that appearance. I mentioned that if it involves a branch, it's more likely malignant, and here you can see the diagram on the right-hand image on the bottom that 44% of those masses that involved a branch were in fact malignant, although certainly benign papillomas can do that, versus only 4% of the isolated introductal mass not involving a branch. In another series of introductal lesions seen on screening ultrasound from the Yale group, 0 of 34 introductal masses seen on screening ultrasound were malignant, again supporting a BI-RADS 3 assessment in that situation. The only malignancy in their series was a retroareolar mass that was not felt to be introductal. Why do we feel palpable masses? Well, it's because they're firmer than the adjacent tissue. That same principle can be used with elastography to determine the stiffness of a lesion, and that influences its likelihood of being malignant. It can be used to selectively upgrade BI-RADS3 lesions that are stiff to biopsy and help us identify the few cancers that otherwise appear to be BI-RADS3 lesions. It can also help us downgrade benign BI-RADS4A lesions away from biopsy and instead do 6-month follow-up. So it actually addresses both sensitivity and specificity. Although importantly, elastography should not be used to alter the management of a BI-RADS4C high suspicion or BI-RADS5 highly suggestive of malignancy mass. We can measure the strain or the shear wave velocity to look at the stiffness of a lesion. Different manufacturers use different approaches. It doesn't work very well in very deep lesions in a large breast, and that's important to keep in mind. And there isn't really great standardization of terminology or application of this technique yet. Shear wave elastography measures the horizontal propagation of low frequency sound waves, which propagate faster in stiff tissue, and this suggests malignancy. Here are some examples. This is a palpable lesion that was proven to be a fibroadenoma. It's homogeneously soft and blue on shear wave elastography. Here are two very similar appearing masses. The one on the left is uniformly soft in a young woman, whereas the lesion on the right is much stiffer with areas that are green and red, indicating faster shear wave velocities. And the lesion on the right indeed was DCIS at excision, and the left-hand lesion was a fibroadenoma. Here is a small circumscribed appearing mass. It looks like it may be a complicated cyst with debris, but it was very stiff on elastography, and this was a high-grade invasive and interductal carcinoma. This approach has been validated in screening in a study in Seoul where Lee and colleagues looked at both the development and validation cohorts and found dramatic improvement in specificity if they downgraded. To summarize, technique is very important in handheld screening ultrasound. It's important that we document lesions other than simple cysts with orthogonal views without and with calipers so that we can see the margins well. And also include a set of Doppler imaging. Our technologists will also include a cine loop when there's any uncertainty on their part, and that can be helpful in reducing unnecessary recalls. 12-month follow-up is reasonable for the vast majority of BI-RADS3 masses seen on screening ultrasound, particularly if they're only seen on screening ultrasound and there's no mammographic correlate, and they can be re-evaluated then at the time of the next annual screening ultrasound. The technologist should review the prior exam and target her imaging to include measurement of any BI-RADS3 masses seen on the prior screening ultrasound, in addition to screening the rest of the tissue. Complicated cysts can be assessed as BI-RADS2, and multiple bilateral non-palpable circumscribed masses can also be assessed as BI-RADS2, provided that you carefully scrutinize each mass. A single 6-month follow-up may be appropriate for it. Biopsy should be pursued for an otherwise BI-RADS3 mass. We'd like to also reduce biopsy of benign BI-RADS4A masses, and we can do that by downgrading to surveillance those that are soft on elastography, especially less than 30 kilopascal. My colleague Dr. Zulli also showed that lack of enhancement on contrast mammography may be appropriately used to downgrade lesions to surveillance, though we need further study of that issue. Thank you for your interest and attention, and I know we have a session later for questions. Thank you.